Deep learning and machine learning seem very diverse fields, but we have seen in this popular diagram that deep learning is a subset of machine learning, which means deep learning is derived from machine learning. But to actually understand what is deep learning, we have to understand this connecting link between them. There are many algorithms in machine learning, but each of them has one fundamental thing in common. Let's see that. This box represents an algorithm that takes X as the input and outputs the prediction. But for the supervised learning algorithm, we also give actual output Y as the reference, so it can compare its prediction with actual values and can see how right it is, which is known as the accuracy of the model. If the results are bad, it tries to optimize itself to make this percentage higher. So how this algorithm is able to do that? Because of the loss function. The loss function tells how much is the error made by our algorithm. In the case of linear regression, this loss function is the mean squared error. For example, if the prediction is 10 and the actual answer should be 8, then the mean squared error will be the actual output minus prediction squared, which will be 4. So our actual aim is to reduce this loss as much as possible. This will be done by the optimizer. In machine learning, we only use gradient descent to optimize the loss function. But in deep learning, we can use various successors of the gradient descent like Adam. In my Under the Hood of ML series, we have implemented Ridge Lasso and ElasticNet using gradient descent. Generally, gradient descent aims to find the minimum value of a function. In this graph, the minimum value is 0. So we will make our first guess at this point. Therefore, gradient descent will start finding the minimum from this point. And eventually, after some iteration, it will find the minimum point. Like this, gradient descent can minimize any function. In our case, that function is loss function. But when we have a function like this, well, there is more than one valley. In our case, there are two valleys. The minimum point here is a local minimum and the point here is the global minimum. If we take our starting guess here and run the gradient descent, it will be able to find the global minimum. But if we just shift the starting point a little bit and run the gradient descent again, it will just get stuck in the local minimum. So just initializing the point here instead of here made a big difference in the performance of our algorithm. To show you it in reality, I have created a gradient descent algorithm from scratch and I have passed it the same function as I showed earlier. Now this x init here means the starting position of x from where it will start the gradient descent. If I set it to 4.7 and run the program, it was able to find the global minimum. But if I set it to 4.4 and run the program again, it just ends up being stuck in the local minimum. This is one of the problems faced by many ML and DL algorithms. But to overcome this, there are many types of initializer in Keras which help to find the starting position of x efficiently so our algorithm converges faster. Now to summarize, we have seen how loss function tells the error made by our algorithm and how gradient descent optimizes loss function to reduce the error. Also how much the initialization matters. If you are well familiar with deep learning, you might find all this very familiar because as I said, deep learning is derived from machine learning. So now let us find that connecting link. This is a normal neural network structure you may have seen in many diagrams. Each of these circles represent a neuron which is doing some kind of calculation. If we only see one out of them and see what it is doing, we can see it is multiplying our x with the weights plus the bias, which is also written in the TensorFlow documentation of dense layer. If we can connect, this formula is of linear regression. But when we work with more complicated data, we want non-linearity. This is when activation functions pop in. This thing here is nothing but an activation function, which does some operation on our output to make it fit in non-linear data. Now there are many activation functions, but one of them is the sigmoid activation. If I write the formula of the sigmoid function and draw the graph, you can see it takes x as the input and maps it in the range 0 to 1. Now after applying this to our neuron, it can fit on non-linear data. This is nothing but the logistic regression. The thing I am trying to convey here is deep learning is made out of very fundamental things of machine learning. Now to join into our previous diagram, we can say that this vibrate value goes to loss function, where it finds the error and according to that error, gradient descent searches for better values and give it to the algorithm. And then this loop will continue for n epochs or n iteration. In machine learning, we call it as max iter, and in deep learning, we call it as epochs. Nothing much changes. Now just imagine all these neurons are working in the same way. That's why when they all work in coordination, they can approximate very complex datasets like predicting the next word in a sentence, driving a car, also known as autonomous vehicle, till landing a rover on a whole different planet. So is machine learning equal to deep learning? The answer is no. They are similar, but not equal, because machine learning is good at dealing with tabular data, and deep learning can deal with more intense stuff like classifying animals in images, translation, natural language processing, like that. Because deep learning lends you the power of choosing activation functions, initializers, regularizers, optimizers, and how many layers and neurons you want in every layer. This was it for today's video. You can check my Under the Hood of Machine Learning series to know more about the algorithms we discussed today. Also, I have many projects like the next word predictor, wake word detection, and image keywording. So check it out. Thanks for watching.